is episode 20, a dual episode with me and Hafsa from Hafsa's Homestead. We are going to be talking all about setting up a chicken brooder today for all those little chicks that we get in the spring, and I'm super excited for this episode today on Cultivating Guts. Hello, it's Tiffany, and welcome back to Cultivating Guts, a podcast where we discuss gardening, homesteading, gut health, and following our intuition. I am so excited to be back with you guys. I've had so many insightful moments, learnings in the garden in the past few weeks, and just ideas that I'm really, really important topics that I'm wanting to share with you on the podcast. And today, I am also simultaneously video recording this podcast. So if you have always wanted to watch me or drop in live on the podcast and see it on video, hop over to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/Tiffany Hinton and welcome to the show. If you are on YouTube, hello, hello. We are eye gazing right now and I'm so excited to see you. I have had this whole like chicken, I don't know, it's not a fetish by any means, but it is a chicken excitement, chicken curiosity, right? And at the beginning of the year, if you were tuning into the podcast or any of the videos that were out on Instagram, you knew that I put chickens on my garden dream board, right? As we were planning the garden and when we were going through the garden webinar series. And so I put these chickens on my dream board. I wasn't committed to them, but I was excited about the possibilities of getting chickens. And then Instagram started showing me chicken reels, and I found Carolina Coops, who we ended up ordering our chicken coop from, which is in production as we're speaking, and we'll be here soon, and I'm trying to get the land leveled and get everything ready. And then I found Hafsa from Hafsa Homestead, and she's all about teaching you how to raise your chickens and how to make sure you have the right supplies and setting up for chicken, you know, and all of this stuff. And it's just like so much education that's like easy to consume. And I was like, oh my gosh, I love her. And a few weeks ago, I got brave enough to message her and see if she would be on the podcast. And I'm super excited and honored for Hafsa to be on the podcast today. And we are talking honestly about setting up for the brooder for the chicks, because we're going to be ordering chicks from the hatchery directly. We're getting Brahma chicks, and I want to make sure we keep them alive in their first few weeks before they get, even in the first month or two, before they get large enough to go right into our chicken coop. And so super, super excited for today's podcast. Before we get started, I want to make sure you subscribe, rate, and review the Cultivating Guts podcast. Send me your screenshots of your review to tiffany@gfmomcertified.com, and we will send you our 4-day Hacking Your Health Gut Detox Plan. Also, if you're listening, screenshot your favorite part and share it with us on Instagram at gfmomcertified or at Cultivating Guts. I love to repost, and I'm excited to hear what you thought of today's episode. And I'm so grateful to you and all of our amazing listeners for helping us to grow the podcast and to share it with more people. And so with that, let's head into the show. All right. Welcome back to Cultivating Guts. Super excited, like I mentioned in the introduction today, to have Hafsa on from Homestead Hafsa. Her Instagram account has just taken off. And everything on there, like I was mentioning, around like chickens and education around chickens and just kind of getting over those fears. And super honored for you to be here today, Hafsa. And if you would, can you introduce yourself a little bit?
Sure, Tiffany. Thank you for having me on today. Again, my name is Hafsa Saleem from Homestead Hafsa. And a lot of people, when they visit my page, they think I've been in farming or homesteading my entire life, or that I've always lived in a rural area. It's actually the exact opposite. I grew up 5 minutes outside of New York City, Manhattan to be exact, in North Jersey. And luckily, I grew up in a very green area and had lots of opportunities for gardening and working outdoors, working with animals. But I still had the city life right there too. So it was a nice contrast to be able to have both. And I've always loved the idea of farming and homesteading, the idea of growing your own food, raising your own animals, whether it's for eggs, for milk, for meat, whatever it may be. And for the last 10 years, I actually was in, or I am still in, traditional business and online business and marketing. It has nothing to do with farming or homesteading. And a few years ago, unfortunately, I lost my mom. I had a single parent growing up. I lost her to cancer. And she always had told me that I should do what I enjoy, what I love most. And I realized after she passed that I really wasn't doing that because, I mean, I love what I do in business and marketing, but we traveled a lot. And I was just waiting for that opportunity to settle down and really dive into homesteading, where this is all that I'm doing every single day, and eventually also turn into some kind of a business. So in early 2020, when everything changed, right, the world kind of came to a stop, we completely stopped traveling for business, and the extra time that we had from being home and doing everything now virtually, we were doing conference calls all day long, which is great. But, you know, we weren't spending that same time on the road, right? So instead, I put it toward our homestead, really growing it out. And within 6 months, this idea of Homestead Hafsa kind of popped into my head. It literally just came into my head one day. And I said to myself, why don't I share what I know on social media? One, because I'm passionate about it, but also I have a background for the last decade in public speaking and being on video. Teaching, and I love it. You know, why don't I just put the two together? And I had this idea to start on YouTube. And then within a few months, I kind of moved over to Instagram. I shifted my focus to Instagram. So now in the last year, I've built it out to what it is. And I started it with the intention of being a platform to educate, to have fun, to build a community, and also to turn it into some kind of business, which now I've done in the last year as well. So this is my full focus in teaching people how to get into homesteading, specifically with chickens, because chickens are what we call the gateway animal to homesteading. They're one of the easiest animals to get started with. Most people, no matter where they live, can have backyard chickens. Even in the cities, people can have backyard chickens. You don't need much land. It doesn't take too much money to get started either. You really don't need any experience. It does take learning though, because obviously that's why I have my page. I have thousands of people that message me so many questions. And I'm like, well, that's why I have my videos. That's why I have my resources. Because I want people to get started the right way, because at the end of the day, they're animals, right? Like, you want to be able to take good care of them. You want them to have a proper diet. You want them to stay healthy, right? You want to know what to do when they're not healthy, right? Because they're not taught, like, you can take your chicken to a veterinarian. You can actually consult an avian veterinarian about your chicken. People have no idea,
right,
that there are poultry vets out there. So even things like that, like, people need to be educated on that.
I love it. There's so many parallels. Oh my gosh. Like, the whole, I grew up on the farm, moved to the city 17 years ago, took a corporate job, and then spoke, but on gut health and celiac disease for 10 years and traveled with that. And then again, everything kind of stopped, everything kind of, and our backyard space was around 60 square feet of gardening space, went to 350 square feet of gardening space. And then this year I was talking to my husband as I was building out dream boards. And I do like the traditional dream board of like, what do we want? And then I started doing garden dream boards, like going through seed catalogs and finding pictures. And I found in one of the seed catalogs, a picture of chickens. And I was like, what do you think? I'm going to put these chickens on the board. I don't know yet. And then probably within 2 weeks, I was like, we're getting chickens. And he's like, okay. And so then I was like, so how many, like, are we traveling? And I was figuring out budgeting. And like you said, it may not take a lot of money, but he's like, you spend so much time in the backyard, just do what you want. So we built a greenhouse, and now the chicken coop is getting ready to go up. And it's like, for me, the perfect time, because I didn't have chickens growing up. I was raised with cattle and pigs and goats. So it's a little bit different, but I want to talk today primarily about setting up a brooder, because when I was doing the research, Tractor Supply Company is actually where I went to their website, because they're across the border in Wisconsin, less than an hour from us. And you can order your chickens and the mailman brings them, which I find utterly very interesting. Like, you get a box of live chicks and then what do you do with them? And that kind of led me down to the Instagram chicken route, which then led me to finding you, Hafsa. And then I've been watching all your crazy videos lately, especially the one with the sideburns and you're like pretending to be your husband, which I find utterly hilarious. And so I want to spend, today kind of talking about setting up a brooder. What do we do when the chickens arrive from the mailman? And maybe some of the listeners didn't even realize that you don't have to go get the chickens. You can order them from the hatchery or from Tractor Supply and they will show up or the mail service will call you. So first of all,
So the first step is before you even buy your chickens, it's important to know why do you want chickens? And I've covered this in many different forms on my platform. I've sent newsletters out on this. I even talk about this in my free introductory class on raising chickens. You need to know why you want to get chickens because there are hundreds of different breeds. Some of them are very high egg layers. Some of them don't lay that many eggs. Some of them lay colorful eggs. If you want to have, you know, Easter color eggs like blue, green, or pink, or even dark brown speckled, you can choose different breeds that lay those color eggs. If you want ones that are cuter or more docile because you have younger kids, there are certain breeds that fall into those categories. And then there are ones that can be raised for both eggs and meat. If somebody wants to down the road, you know, be able to process them also for meat, they can do that. And there are ones that are specifically only for meat that need to be processed within 2 to 3 months because they don't live past that point.
Oh my gosh, wow.
So it's important to first know why someone wants to get chickens, and then they can decide what breeds to get. And then they can also decide how many to get based on where they live and what they want. Like if they want to have a certain number of eggs per week, they can kind of work backwards if they know, okay, if I get 5 hens that lay 200 eggs each per year, you know, do the math, figure out how much that is per week. Is that enough for my household? Mm-hmm. Right? Because some people want to make sure that they have enough eggs so they're not going out and having to buy them, and then they maybe have more than enough, right?
Yeah.
So first know that, like, it's really important to note, like, do your research before even attempting to go and buy chickens. And that's a mistake that many people make, is that they walk into a store like Tractor Supply, for example, and they see the chicks and they get really excited and they just buy them and they bring them home. And one, they don't know much about the breeds that they bought. Two, maybe they didn't even set up their brooder yet. Mm-hmm. And for those of you on the line listening who are like saying, what on earth is a brooder is simply a heated enclosure for your baby chicks. And I say heated because it has to be heated before you even bring them home. And I've mentioned this in several different posts. Like, a lot of my videos are funny, but if you actually go into the caption, you'll see like, okay, like,
super
set
helpful.
Everything up before you bring your chicks home. And the main components to a chick brooder are, number one, the heat. The heat has to be on at least a few hours before, because when you're bringing them home or even when they're delivered to you through the mail, they're already in a very like warm space, right? Mm-hmm. So if you put them into a large container, like a plastic tub or a cardboard box or a galvanized metal tub, these are all different types mm-hmm. of enclosures that you can use for a brooder. If that space is not heated up enough, or if it's just like kind of cold, it's a shock to their body and they can get sick. And unfortunately mm-hmm. they can even die from that. So it needs
difference.
To be heated up. Yeah. When they're a day old, it starts at 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And equally, the room should also be warm. Like, there shouldn't be any drafts. The window should not be open if there's a window, right? If there's a big gap underneath the door, like, stuff a towel underneath the door. So there's no gap.
Like,
there's
creating
no
like this little sauna.
And it needs to be a sauna for at least a few weeks, for at least up to 3 weeks. And then you can kind of tone it down.
Okay.
But the way with the brooder works with the heat is you basically decrease the heat inside the brooder by 5 degrees Fahrenheit every week. So 100 degrees, week one, then 95, then 90, then 85, and so on and so forth. You bring it down. And most people get chicks in the spring because by week 4 to 6, it's warm enough outside at night where they can be moved outdoors. And it needs to be at least 50 degrees at night for them to be outside full time without a heater. Now, you can move them outside before that point as long as you put a heater in there.
Mm-hmm.
And when it comes to heat, also, there's two types. There's a heat lamp bulb or heat lamp mm-hmm. and the radiant heat plate. My preference is the radiant heat because it's far more energy efficient, but it's also safer for them.
Yeah.
And it also, it feels like they're really underneath their mother hen when they're sitting under. It's just basically a big, I have one here, actually. I have chick brooder right here behind me. Yeah, I've got like 24 little babies.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. So I think of like in the greenhouse, we get like these mats that we put underneath the seedlings so that they get the heat so that they're actually similar. Germinate. So similar very concept. Similar. Okay.
Very similar. Yeah. So in fact, I recently did a post about this and someone said, well, they commented, they're like, well, what if I'm living off grid? Can I just build them a small fire? I'm like, no. No.
Solar power.
It would have to be on like for 4 weeks. Like, and that's dangerous. No.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
You need a radiant heat plate. It needs to be plugged in and on 24/7 for a minimum of a few weeks. And like, depending on where you live, like if you live in an area where, you know, within a few weeks of buying the chicks, it's 90 degrees outside during the day and it's over 50 at night. Like you can move them outside and not have a heater, you know?
That. Okay.
And that I actually like doing that when you get chicks later on in the year, you can kind of skip the brooder process. Is also if you get them when they're a little bit older.
Okay.
Now if you're mail ordering chicks or if you're buying them from a store like Tractor Supply, they're going to be anywhere from a day old to a few days old. So in that situation, you would need a heater.
Still need a heater.
But right. If you're buying them from a farm, so I've most of the time bought them from a local farm before we moved to a farm ourselves, and now we have hundreds of chickens where we are. I used to buy them when they were at least 2 to 3 weeks old in the spring and the summer, so I could just skip the brooder and just or at least the heater part, and then have them be moved outside. So the heat is the top thing. Obviously the container, it should be deep enough so that they're not flying out and there shouldn't be children or, you know, other animals like cats and dogs.
They're wonderful in their cat. Yeah. So our breeder is probably going to be built in the greenhouse for the very reason that there's outdoor cats and there's an indoor cat. And I'm just like, we're just going to secure you guys up.
Same. We have one outdoor, one indoor.
Yeah.
So yeah, we the one that's outdoor actually really doesn't care about the chicks. He just looks at them and walks away. And then the one that's indoor, the moment I open this door, he runs inside and he just sits here and watches them. And he's had a couple moments where he's trying to jump in, and I'm like, no.
Yeah.
But he's very curious, but it's because he's indoors. He doesn't like go outside and chase after birds, right? So yeah, you have the heat. The actual container for the chicks.
Bedding. What is it? I know you said so they couldn't fly out, but is that like a foot and a half, 2 feet deep?
I would say at least 2 feet deep is a good start. If someone is raising them in the wintertime, then it has to be a lot deeper because they're going to be in that container for 3 months or more, depending on how cold the winter is. So some people give their chicks an entire room in that situation, or like if they have a basement or a spare room, they'll make the entire room into a brooder where the chicks can run around and, you know, have enough space even up until 3 months or more because it's just too cold outside for them.
Gotcha.
Maybe there's a lot of snow as well.
Yeah.
But for most people in the spring, usually between 6 to 8 weeks, that's more than enough time to have them indoors before moving them outside. So you have those two, and then you have the bedding. There's a lot of different options for bedding for chicks. My personal preference is hemp bedding because it lasts a lot longer. It's a lot safer for them because it's very minimal dust. Pine shavings is pretty popular, but pine shavings, you have to clean it out like every week because it becomes a mess very quickly. And then it adds a lot of dust to the room, and then the chicks end up inhaling it, but you also end up inhaling it. That's why I prefer hemp bedding. So that's the only thing that we use now for our entire flock. The feeders, the waterers, it's pretty easy to find them at Tractor Supply or any farm supply store. You go to Amazon, you find feeders and waters. I recommend hanging them from my last video. Yeah, you hang them because then you're not going to be cleaning it, you know, 5-6 times. Like somebody commented, she said, I clean out my waters like 6 times a day. This is going to help me so much.
A friend of mine in LA got her chicks 2 weeks ago, and that's been her biggest complaint. She's like, the water is everywhere. So
yeah,
that makes sense.
So let gravity do its thing. If you hang it, it'll stay straight. They won't be able to knock it over, and they won't be able to kick the bedding up
either. And is there specific food when they're that young that you buy versus other grains?
So for all chickens, you have, no matter the breeds, you have chick starter grower feed, which it depends on the brand. But for most brands, it's from when they're a day old to 18 weeks old. And then you have layer feed after they're 18 weeks old. You could give them that. The chick feed is always a crumble form. And there's many different brands out there. We go with Nutrina for our entire flock. You have the option of medicated, non-medicated, organic, mm-hmm. non-organic. The organic, non-organic really is personal preference. For me, like the one that we use with Nutrina, they're not allowed to put organic on it, but it's natural. Mm-hmm. I mean, they can't use the term organic. Nother natural is good enough for me. Medicated and non-medicated, that one does matter. If someone gets their chicks vaccinated for one of the illnesses, which is called coccidiosis, then they do not need to also give medicated feed.
Okay.
Like you don't do both. You don't get your chicks vaccinated plus give them medicated feed. It's one or the other. If you don't get them vaccinated for vaccinations or for feed.
For like to vaccinate versus not vaccinate.
That also, I think, is personal preference okay. in most situations. We personally do not vaccinate the chicks. We're just more careful with how we raise them, and we practice biosecurity, which means, you know, we limit visitors. We make sure that every chick area or chicken area, like every space is enclosed and they're kept separate. So when you bring in new chicks, for example, or new chickens of any age, you don't mix them in with your existing flock because they could have some illness that could spread. So as long as you're practicing those types of things and you're careful, I don't personally believe that it's necessary, mm-hmm. except if your area, there's a disease called Merrick's disease, which is fatal. And it's unfortunately, it's very quick to kill them. Mm. It can live in the soil. So if you have chickens and maybe the person who lived there before you had any kind of, animals, they had chickens, they had guinea fowl, they had turkeys, any of those, any poultry, and they had Merrick's. Even if they died, the disease can still live in the soil. So in that situation, it is a good idea to get your chicks vaccinated for Merrick's. Now that might not be as common because I don't mm-hmm. know if someone would be able to even know if their property had Merrick's on it, but
yeah.
if you're moving to like a farm or something, like especially a chicken farm, and there's a history of it, then you'll usually know if there was a history of it.
There were pigeons on our property about probably 30 years ago. Off in the way back corner.
Pigeons get it.
I have no idea. And I don't know why they kept pigeons either. It's just kind of random, but
yeah.
Okay.
So then you have the feed and then electrolytes and probiotics, which also are made specific. There's ones made specifically for chicks. So sometimes people ask me, can I just give them Gatorade? I'm not going to stop you, but I mean, I would recommend buy the stuff that's made specifically for baby chicks.
Yeah.
Electrolytes and probiotics mix. You mix it into the water and you give it to them for a few days. That's also really important to have when you get your chicks, because when you first bring them home, they're usually in a state of shock from the travel, even if uh-huh. they were just in the car for 30 minutes, right? They're little babies. They're not right. used to that, right?
Yeah, it's like almost like hyper overdrive, everything yes. happening. Yeah.
So when you bring them home, you should have a separate water just for that, and then one just with regular plain water with nothing added to it.
Okay.
So that's the basics of getting started with chicks.
I have read that you should have like mineral water, or you shouldn't give them tap water. You should like do sustainable rainwater collection and add, you know, antibiotic to the rainwater. Like there's so much out there.
I think it's all personal preference.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's another thing. So a few years ago when I really started diving into homesteading and specifically chickens, so beginning of 2020, I started putting a lot of my time into seeing what's going on in the chicken world, you could say, online. Now, I had already worked on a farm before that. Like now it's been 15 years ago. I worked on a farm in college. So at my college campus, we actually had a farm with over 1,000 animals. So oh, I wow. took care of chickens, horses, cows, goats, sheep, donkeys, pigs, every farm animal you could think of, right? So I already had experience like working on a farm every day around going to school full time. So when I got into researching in the last few years, I heavily got into researching online on YouTube and, you know, different platforms online. I found that there's a lot of conflicting info. Mm-hmm. It's for a brand new person who knows nothing about raising farm animals. It's overwhelming and it's really confusing, as you know, as it can be. And that's actually one of the reasons why I also decided to create this idea of Homestead Hafsa, to help people find the answers they're looking for, but to be able to also easily understand it and to be able to relate to someone maybe with a similar background, because I have a professional business background. I come from a major city area, right?
Yeah.
I understand that when somebody learns about chicken terminology like brooder and pullet and cockerel and straight run, they're like, what on earth are these terms? I get it. I've been there because I did not grow up on a farm, right? I don't have a single person in my family who enjoys raising chickens or any animals for that matter. I'm the only crazy animal person. And in fact, now I'm actually, when I was in college, my intention was to go to veterinary school. It didn't work out back then, but now I actually am going to be going back to school for veterinary. But that, like, it's because I'm just like obsessed.
It's like a passion, right? And it's kind of this drive.
It's a passion. Yeah. And now I've been able to, you know, 100% put my efforts towards it. And that's really where you have success in anything, right? When you put your blinders on and you just focus on that one thing. And that's where the success is.
Yeah, for sure. Oh my gosh. There's so much, like, now I'm just like even more excited. So even back to the beginning, when you were talking about like picking chickens, we started out with looking at egg colors because I have three girls and their biggest thing is, right, colors and fashion and all this stuff. And so they're like, we need chickens that lay pink eggs. I was like, okay, let's narrow down all the breeds that have pink eggs. And then because of my gardening background, I'm like, we got to find them for our zone. So like, who's going to hang out in super cold Chicago where it's like negative 50 degrees some winters? And so we've landed on getting Brahma chickens because they do lay eggs. They've got fur on, or not fur, they have feathers on their feet. They're supposed to be really good. And even like Northern Wisconsin is what I'm hearing. And they're docile and we can butcher them. So that's where we're headed. We're getting the Brahmas.
There's a specific one that lays pink eggs, which we also have. It's the buff Brahma.
Okay.
The regular Brahmas lay like a cream or light brown, but the buff Brahmas
lays pink eggs.
And then some astrolorps also lay pink eggs.
Okay.
And it can vary depending on how it was bred. So like some chickens, for example, like Easter eggers, they can lay pink, green, or blue. And you won't know until that chicken starts laying. And then whatever it lays, it's going to continue to lay that color egg.
Interesting. So, yeah.
So yeah, for cold areas, I would definitely recommend those two, though. The astrolorp and the buff Brahma.
Okay, cool. Good to know. Yeah. And then the other thing was, I'm like, there's other cats. So then I need the chicken that's larger. So it somewhat, hopefully, is bigger than the cat.
Yes, they are big.
All these things are going into our little planning process. And now it's a matter of leveling and putting the coop in and then going into Wisconsin to get supplies to set up the brooder and to get everything kind of ready to go before we order the actual chickens and not come home with chickens the day we go get the supplies. That'll be the tricky part. Yeah.
I'm sure you'll get everything set up beforehand.
I think it's pretty easy.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to get set up.
What is one mistake you see a lot of people make when they're getting started with chickens?
One, what I just mentioned, but secondly, also underestimating predators. Mm. A lot of people have no clue that chickens have a lot of predators. And even when you build what you think is a secure coop or a secure run, animals still find a way to get in, whether it's hawks and owls or something small like a mink. Mm-hmm. A tiny little mink can take out an entire flock. So one of our friends, he lost, I think, over 80 chickens in a matter of 4 nights because of one mink that he couldn't catch, because it's this tiny little thing, right? It kept going in holes underneath the pens that he has every night until they finally trapped it and got it. So predators can be very devastating, So one is not being aware of it, and then secondly, feeling guilty about it. A lot of times people feel so bad about it that they're like, I don't even want to have chickens ever again, because they're just so like distraught over it.
Kind of get attached. But they don't realize it. Yeah.
Yes, but they don't. But that's not just that. They feel bad. Like they feel like it's their fault, and it's really not. Even when you do the best that you possibly can, things happen, and it's nature, and it takes time to understand that. And the more chickens you have, obviously, the more likely you're going to lose one or more to a predator. And every time it happens, it's going to sound bad. It hurts less and less. It still hurts. It's still like,
growing up,
out and find an animal like dead with like, it's not horrible, but like, you know, blood and like feathers everywhere. You know, you gotta clean it up, and you gotta bury it or do something with it, right?
Yep.
So that's the hardest part, dealing with predators and the aftermath of that.
Yeah. I think it's something too. If like I grew up the first 5 years actually on a farm, and then we kind of moved to town, but being around a farm that was raising livestock for the larger, like to be butchered, that was the intention. You kind of got that hard skin super young, like, or you would walk out and they had birth in the middle of the night and it didn't make it. And it just became part of my childhood. But I can see where people that didn't have that experience, where it was everyday normal, there is that getting used to it.
It takes a long time for most people to adjust to that fact.
Awesome. I am so grateful for everything you've shared with us today. I do want to ask you a little bit about the ebook, and can you share how people can find that, because I think that's a huge resource that you have available.
Sure. You can just find me at homesteadhafsa.com or Instagram at homesteadhafsa, and you can click the link in my bio. You could also just go to eggcitedforchickens.com. Eggcited is EGG, eggcitedforchickens.com. It goes to my ebook page, and I also have an online course where I have a recorded course, which goes into it in a lot more depth. And then people can also have a one-on-one call with me to actually help them with their setup or any issues they're having with their flock. Because that one-on-one conversation helps a lot more sometimes.
Absolutely. I think it's almost like you're a coach in that chicken world. Because everybody has, right? Their trainer for whatever. They've got their dietitian. They've got whatever. And And so that's I love that. One-on-one chicken.
That's coach. Actually my signature, your chicken keeping coach.
That's awesome. So very cool. One last question for you that we love to ask on the podcast. How do you cultivate guts every day in life?
I think it comes from within, just making a decision, knowing what you're doing, knowing why you're doing it, I think is a bigger reason, right? Knowing your why behind anything that you do is going to keep you moving forward.
I love that. Yeah. That gut. Whatever it is, and just driving you forward with it.
I've always had that with, like, people have always said that to me, like anything that I've done, anything that I've had an interest in, I've always been very passionate about it, always pursued it. So and I don't let other people's opinions get in the way, or even my own opinions in the back of my head saying you're crazy, right? Because I think we all have that voice.
You do.
And it can be applied to anything that you're doing, whether it's, you know, farming, it's education, it's parenting, it's business, whatever it is. Just know why you're doing it and just do it.
It's a great answer and such great advice. Thank you again, Hafsa, for being on the podcast. Really appreciate you, and super grateful.
Thank you, Tiffany.
All right, you guys, I hope you enjoyed that episode as much as I did. Share with me your favorite part, and share with me when you're going to start raising your own chickens or when you're setting up your brooder. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out or message Homestead Hafsa right on Instagram over on her page. I would encourage you to get her ebook. We'll take her free class and reach out if you need chicken coaching. That is just something that is awesome that she offers, and she is such a great resource. I'm here for you, and I'm excited to see all your benefits. Sat Nam, I love you guys. So if you love this episode, remember to share it with your friends. Send it to anyone who may love this inspiration and information that we shared. And to get my newest book, The Ultimate Green Witch Gardening Planner, you're going to visit Amazon or www.cultivatingguts.com to pick up the planner there. You can get it printed or in digital version. And it's not too late to start your garden and to get planning. The planner is a 6-month version, so you can use it for multiple garden seasons. To get all those details, head over to www.cultivatingguts.com and you'll see everything you need to get started with your gardening, to in your homestead, and to get the stuff you need to get going and growing your own food to help your gut.